a sleep disorder in which you have trouble falling in or staying asleep. The condition can be short-term, which is known as acute insomnia, or can last a long time, which is then known as chronic insomnia. It will also come and go. Acute insomnia lasts from 1 month to a few weeks, while chronic insomnia happens at least 3 nights a week or for 3 months or more. And to get some more info on this, we're going to go to general practitioner for 3 months in Makemba. And you're definitely welcome. Thank you for being here. Dr. Watts classifies it as insomnia. Obviously, I gave a bit of a description in the intro. But is it really as simple as the inability to have some sleep? What if it's neither either or of what you've just mentioned? So it's sort of a mixture, or it's in between the two. How are you able to then identify that, okay, this is now insomnia?
Yeah, I mean, when it's just
Are there any other symptoms that accompany not being able to sleep? For example, if you know you get headaches, or you know, loss of appetite, or you know, aching muscles or something.
Yes, then when you put into right space, you probably don't have any other causes. When you've got primary insomnia, when you probably have a difficult sleeping, but just more other identifying the secondary causes. Mm-hmm. Then you've got the secondary insomnia, or maybe the reason why you're not able to sleep is because now you have diabetes.
So diet and lifestyle habits definitely play a big role?
Definitely, because if you look at what we call high glycemic index, food or diet, if you don't know that I'm eating it, that's sugar. Because once you consume such food, that sugar is really available and absorbed into your system. And sugar is energy, so that keeps you, you know, neutralize your system, and then you're energetic and you're probably going to be able to sleep. If not, for instance, somebody eats quite excessively, and maybe they pick up quite a significant amount of weight, when you go to bed, because the amount is quite big, they are asleep, the muscles are relaxed, you know, the neck, because of all the sense of, you know, process that we have over there, what we are not able to do properly, the technology that is here, all of that can actually contribute to what we are having a problem today. And obviously, just in the way that it was with the company, it really goes back to the early days that we thought about television at midnight, the other day it was gone. So if you do not have that proper sleeping pattern for yourself, that also can become a problem.
A lot of times we see that insomnia is sort of treated with medication. Is this the correct and only way to go about treating this disorder or this condition?
Probably not. Obviously, medication-wise, we use a molecule called But obviously, there has been a lot of advancement in the research and people are thinking about cannabis. Exercises, for instance, is quite a good one because when you exercise, you release endorphins, which are feel good hormones. And then when you feel good, you know, when you come to bed later, because when the mood speaks, you know, you're exercising, you're right, you react to like your body 10% of nature. People are doing things like yoga, you know, relaxation techniques, you know, doing things like, you know, meditations, you know, in countries where cannabis is actually used for medical reasons, you know, sometimes the body community, you know, limited, you know, small dose, you know, consumption of things like that, you know, things, you know, controlled environment of this one thing. So all these things, you know, somehow really works well. And obviously, if you just work on your problems, you know, where you have a proper sleeping pattern for you, then you go to bed almost consistently at a particular time. Well, that helps you then so when it comes to that, you get that. And then obviously cutting out things like your alcohol, when you're smoking and drinking coffee late at night, you know, so that it doesn't stimulate your thinking.
Yeah. I know a lot of people that self-medicate when it comes to insomnia. So you know, you go to the pharmacy, you get something on the shelf over the counter to help you sleep, but it's actually quite silly. You're not going to cut out caffeine.
Yeah,
you're not going to cut out smoking
before you sleep. Yeah, because it's kind of intuitive, because you might try to get a drug to help you sleep, but if you're consuming something that is stimulating you, so it's, you know, it's not productive in way of doing that. Good. So the ideal pattern of the good is obviously to adopt the medication so that the doctor can sit in front of you. If I don't know what your lifestyle is, you know, there's an identifiable cause, which is something that can be taken care of. And often there we find that if you deal with whatever might be the reason why you're not sleeping, you might not even need the medication.
Dr. Any final remarks from you this evening?
I like some of them too, because I've realized, you know, this evening is that, you know, insomnia is really, you know, identifiable medical condition. It can impact one's quality of life and productivity, particularly the next day, the next day, quite a lot. The idea would then be, you know, go to the doctor, first thing you can talk to the doctor, first thing you can talk to the doctor, and you will be able to.
Thank you so much.
Always a pleasure.
Doctor, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
I was Dr. Nelson Makemba speaking to us this evening about insomnia. Let's take a quick break.